lollygaggers. Another week on tap, lollygagging sports. I am Bo Reed, along with Samantha Button and Matthew Irby. Thought I'd change it up there. Samantha, get a little Nelly on.
It's some of Nelly's best work.
I agree.
And I know we did a whole segment on Nelly, and that song, unfortunately, was not really part of it because there are no sports references in it. That is a solid song. That's like late stage Nelly, too.
Yeah.
But after his peak. Very, very good. Love that he drops the casual Usher reference in there, too. Also cool. Oh, I wonder what Nelly's up to now. I hope he's doing good.
Obviously, he's listening to our podcast and going to threaten to sue us for using his song.
Oh, I hope not. If Nelly tries to sue us, I'm just going to be like, listen, we did a whole segment on you. It was positive. Like, you can play this stuff.
Oh boy, Irby, how about you? How you doing? Before we get started here,
I'm good. Not as good as Nelly, I'm sure, but no complaints. All is well. All is well. Our Rangers are in the middle of a doubleheader against the lowercase White Sox, and you know.
By the way, when you have one suspended game, apparently you have more. Because, you know, it wasn't technically, yeah, doubleheader, but like the first game was suspended, even though only four pitches were thrown last night before the rain delay.
Yeah, who was in charge of that? That cracked me up. It was like, you really, I mean, come on, this isn't weather from 100 years ago. Like, you really couldn't see that and be like, let's hold off on these four pitches and see what this storm does. But I think that's also how much they care about the Rangers and the White Sox right now.
My favorite part, though, was they said it just appeared.
Run.
It just popped up and it was there right on top of the stadium.
Oh, this is like when the fireplace just appears in the Santa Claus, when he's like, it just kind of appeared.
Yeah, there you go.
Exactly. It's a magic storm.
Four pitches. Incredible. That's a suspended game. Wow.
Which I got to ask, well, it's bad enough that you do the whole, you know, tried to start the game, the guy threw four pitches, and then we had to call it, right? Why is that a suspended game? I feel like that is a very safe just start over.
Yeah, I feel like you just need to, if you don't make it through an inning, like, I feel like you just quit and start over. Especially four pitches. Did the first batter hit a home run? No. So no runs have been scored. Just start over.
Well, hold on. Marcus had three balls at the time. He did work the walk to begin today, and that was a run in a game, in a 3-1 game that mattered. I'm trying to justify, but that actually, this one did matter.
There you go. Then that's either the reason not to start it in the first place, or I guess you can't start it over that.
Well, and it was Garrett pitching for the White Sox, and he was done. They didn't use him today at all. I'm sure Grady Sizemore appreciated that. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, and I mean, I wonder, too, if we weren't talking about Garrett, who is, like, very notoriously on an innings limit, if the starter doesn't just come back the next day and start. But it probably depends on the guy. But that would make me mad if it happened to me to burn a starter on four pitches. I would be furious.
Yeah, I would be too. I would be screaming. But it was like, no, we're going to play. You started this. We're going to finish it. We're going to play. I mean, come on. But it's okay. The storm just appeared. as if it was conjured by a fan.
There you go. Yeah.
We were accused of conjuring wind, of turning wind on and off earlier this season at Progressive Field.
Amazing.
So, wow.
You know.
Well done.
Yeah.
If you guys were
doing it again,
if you guys were doing
why
that,
why are you doing it again?
Why don't you have a 10-game lead over everybody if you had that power?
And that's all I'm saying. Like, listen, man, if I knew how to turn the wind on and off in right field by inning, do you think I would ever let you take a single game from me, you bozos?
So since you have this witchcraft ability, what pitcher most likely on the Guardian staff would be the one to be like, no, I want the wind. Give me the wind.
Oh, it's Tanner Bybee. Tanner Bybee would be like, I will beat the wind. I will do it. And he might, actually. No, he's the guy who would be like, no, put the wind on.
No, turn the wind on, guys. Turn it. It goes to 11.
Yeah, or Class A for like a totally different reason, because Class A, you know, sometimes he creates excitement just because, like, I guess it's not exciting enough for nothing. You know, he's going to put a couple of runners on to scare the crap out of everybody. You know, he just needs it to be more exciting. So I could see Class A being like, put the wind on. I want to see what happens. Could happen. I don't know. We're going to talk to whoever's in charge of this wind, alleged wind.
I mean, at that point, you're guaranteeing yourself at least worst case scenario, 500 record, because you'd be 81-0 at home.
Yeah, if you left the wind on all the time. If you controlled the wind at will, yeah, you would win 81 games. I mean, you'd probably have to throw a couple just so it didn't look too suspicious. A couple. You know? But like...
Oh no, the Marlins beat us. Darn.
Because 79-2 is that's not as suspect as 81-0.
Yeah, you just like, you dump your games to like the White Sox, you know, you dump your games to like, you'd have to pick somebody who was like a little better. So you pick like a middling NL team, somebody's fringy, you know, you throw a couple games to like the Mets or something, somebody like that, like mid tier St. Louis, you know, those kinds of teams. Like, hey, they could have beaten us. It's possible. But like these bozos saying that we did this, it's like, do you think I would give you a single win in my ballpark if I could do this? Of course not. This is so dumb. Oh, man. Wow. Amazing.
So on that note, Samantha, you want to kick off our baseball conversation for the week?
Sure. Well, I mean, we could stick with suspended games. Let's just like pick a slightly better circumstance than suspended game, or at least something that produced an interesting circumstance. So, you know how nothing's ever a record when it happens in baseball. It's weird, but it's usually not a record because the sport has been around so long. There has been, you know, so many tremendous accomplishments in the history of the sport. So many weird things that have happened. Like my mom is always, every time something happens that seems exceptional, she's always like, is that a record? And you feel like, no, it's not a record. And actually the answer to that is always no. But we did have a first in baseball on Monday. And so I decided to take myself to Fenway for the day so that I could go witness Danny Jansen playing for two teams in the same game, which has never happened before. So very cool stuff. Danny Jansen game. Just felt like I needed to witness a little history in person. Not as weird as it could have been, I got to say. You know, you're really, really hoping Dal Farsho gets that hit in the pinch hit appearance that he has to make for Danny Jansen. You know, Danny Jansen did get a hit for Boston in this game, but it's a shame he didn't also get one for Toronto, because one of the most interesting things about this is like the fact that a lot of the guys who do the like statistical modeling for the stat aggregators said this might be like the Y2K of baseball if this happens. Like, we don't know what the computer will do with Danny Jansen being seemingly in two places at once. And I think there were some circumstances that could have happened that might have made this a little bit more interesting, but so very cool to see. Is always hoping to go to Fenway, obviously, but always good to get to witness a bizarre little piece of history, and, you know, especially something like this, because I love, like, weirdo stuff in baseball. So totally worth going. Very, very cool. The Danny Jansen game. We now have a Major League Baseball player who has, in fact, played for two teams in the same game for the first time ever.
It's actually kind of remarkable to me that this hasn't happened before.
Yeah, that's what I thought too.
Right? Because I mean, you think about it, like, that's why, I mean, you orchestrated perfect, or illustrated perfectly there, right? Like, there's never, it's happened before. The answer is always no, it's not a record. It's happened before. It may have happened in 1912, but it happened before, because that's baseball. It's over 100 years old, right? So a lot of things can happen.
Oh, yeah.
Well, right? In 100 years. So it's rather remarkable, because, I mean, we do that. We take things that are rare and treat them like they're records in baseball, because there's just no records left to set. No weird things left to do, except what we can't think of, which is, this is a perfect one that we could never think of, two players playing in the same game for both teams.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, we know part of the reason we love baseball so much is because, you know, think of that old saying, if you want to see something you've never seen before, go to a baseball game. And you do, really. All the time you see something strange that you're like, I've never seen that before. But it doesn't necessarily mean that, A, it hasn't happened, or, B, that it's anything that's going to be something that would necessarily be a record of some sort. It's just weird, you know, like the ball getting stuck in the wall or whatever, some weird thing like that. It's not really a record, right? It's just a weird thing. So to see something like this that actually is a statistical record is, like, beyond bizarre. Because we've had, like, I mean, we've had people play for two games in the same day for two different teams because they got traded. We've had people get traded to a team involving a suspended game before, but it was never anybody who had played in the first part of the game. So it's, like, weird, because I'm with you. It's strange that it's never happened before, but we've had a lot of things that kind of have, you know, been in the same orbit that have kind of circled around this, and it's just that all the pieces of this have really come together before. And also, huge thank you to Alex Cora, because Danny Jansen is not just starting catcher there, so there was really no reason to assume he would be in the lineup for Boston. And I guess we all just bugged him so much because we'd all been, you know, talking about this for like a month before it happened, like, oh, wouldn't it be so cool if they had to sub him in? And Alex Cora very helpfully said, yes, I will do this for you. So super cool of him to go ahead and do that so that history can be made.
Obi, how about you? Got any thoughts on this one?
Yes, Danny Jansen Day was awesome. Love when these things work out. And it rarely does. Like you said, this is the first time ever baseball does sign just these new things. And so this is great. Wonderful for Alex Cora to be a part of it and make it happen for the fans. Samantha, so happy for you and the kiddos getting to go out there and see this. And because it is one of those things that most people are going, why? It's like, well, because it's never happened before. That's it. That's all I want to see. Like, the game will play out how the game plays out. Yes, these statistical anomalies are wonderful. And it would have been amazing if he had had an 0-2 count when the game was suspended and could have gotten the strikeout, maybe even drop the ball as the catcher and officially tag himself out. That would have been a great cape to you. But whatever, take it. It was a win. Also love the George Springer stat, getting his 7th and his 19th home run in the same game.
That's funny.
that was great. That was love when those things pop up, because that's exactly how it goes down. There's 7th and your 19th home run. And it'll look like that in the box score. And those are the things, I don't know, I've done enough baseball research in my life, but those are the things I love to know 100 years from now. Someone's going to read that and go, wait, what? What? How did you do that?
Oh, yeah. Whoever hosts Lollygagging, you know, 70 years from now, like, there's going to be a whole, yeah, like, somebody's going to be looking for the retro sheet that explains this. How do you go from 7 to 19 in one game? Is this a mistake? You know, they have to go through the whole process, and it's like, nope. Some weirdness.
You know what's another fun one with that is the when there's some weird, like, rundown, just looking at the numbers, it is fantastic when you're like, okay, 7 to 8 to 2 to 9 to 4. Wait, what? What are y'all doing?
Well, you know, we just have to keep in mind for our whoever takes this over after we're going to hang them up. It's episode 96. That's the one we're on where this is discussed. They can go back and pull the audio, you know, maybe include that.
There you go.
So, you know, got that going for us. All right, Samantha, what else do you have?
All right, well, here's something we don't want anyone pulling audio on, right? Because, like, we were wrong. You know, we pride ourselves on being pretty good at this stuff and being able to predict things at least reasonably well, or as well as anyone can in a sport where, just like, as we've just talked about, wild things happen. But, you know, here's a big one that we were wrong about. We talked before the season, I think it was before the season started, right? When Bobby Witt Jr. signed that huge contract extension with the Royals, we were like, well, this is going to be a mistake. And it sure looks like it was not. a mistake, because Bobby Witt Jr. has been amazing. Looks like he's going to be worth every penny. We talked a lot about why would you do this now when your team's not competitive, and poof, their team is in fact competitive. So, you know, apologies mostly to Bobby Witt Jr., but also to the Royals, who, you know, I think have been relatively savvy about the way that they do business. They're not always competitive, but they seem to be pretty good at timing. We saw that with their last World Series run. They've made some contract decisions that I thought were good but not right, I guess is the way that I would put it, where they've kind of given some extensions perhaps to people because they were fan favorites and not because they were particularly productive. But, you know, even the Salvi contract, which I think we all kind of looked at as, well, this is a nice thing to do for your fans while you're not competitive. Like, I don't know, you know, Salvi's still pretty good. So that's looking pretty smart, too. So you have to give a lot of credit to the Royals front office. And I'm a Dayton Moore apologist. So, you know, I'm not necessarily on board with all these people who are like, well, now that we've gotten rid of Dayton Moore, everything will be fine. It's like, well, Dayton Moore kind of winning a World Series. So I actually really like the way he built that team. And I think he paved the way for what we're seeing now out of that front office. But hey, you know, like our apologies. I mean, right now I'm sneering at you because you were tied with us for one day in first place and acting like our season was over and you were going to win the division. Now you're right back in second place where you belong. But sorry, I had to. But I like Bobby Witt Jr. and I don't dislike the Royals at all unless I'm playing them. So I think this is good. I, you know, credit where credit's due. This was smart. This looks like it was actually a really, really good decision on their part.
Well, I mean, I don't think there's any question that he has established himself now. You know, before, like, the argument was, well, you know, I need to see it again. Because we saw it last year. Before that, it was a struggle. Like, we need to see it again. Well, we saw it again. So, on that side of the coin, yeah. Well, now, what I need to see is from the Royals. Like,
yeah.
I need to see you actually put money into your roster, because it can't be Bobby Witt and 24 guys. We've seen that movie before, and it always ends badly. And, yeah, they are competitive now, but you've also got some veterans on that team. They're going to have to be replaced pretty soon. Some are on their last run. They're on their last ride. And you've got to have the money to do that. And if you gave all of it to Bobby Witt, it's just going to be a problem down the road. I'm cautiously optimistic, but now I need to see – we've seen it from Bobby Witt. Now I need to see it from the Royals.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you're making – that's a very fair counterpoint to us just saying, well, we were wrong, is that – yeah, Bobby Witt Jr. was going to be on the Royals this year no matter what. So it's not like you needed to pay him now. It's not like he wasn't going to be there next year if you didn't offer him a contract. Now, he isn't going anywhere anytime soon, right? You're just buying out his arb years at the beginning of this.
Right.
So, yeah, there is another piece to this, and I'm glad you pointed that out. And maybe we will turn out to be less wrong than we thought, because it's like, yeah, Bobby Witt Jr. could perform very well for the duration of this contract. But if you spent all of your money on a guy who is going to tail off ultimately at the end of this, I mean, he is very young, so you've done a better job, I think, of, you know, capturing his peak years. And, you know, that's one good reason to sign him early, that you're not paying for a lack of productivity on the back end of a contract like you normally would be if you waited it out and did this, like, post-arb. But there is the problem, like you said, that, like, Royals, as much as they have been much, much better than anyone thought they would be this season, they're very competitive, they're probably going to the playoffs, they're probably also not winning. I don't think they're going to win a World Series this year, right? So you have to stay competitive, but a lot of these guys are getting old. A lot of the people on that team are not signed to long-term deals. So if you spent all of your money on Bobby Witt Jr. now, then you better be hoping you're going to win a World Series in the next couple of years.
Yeah.
Because when you lose the talent you have now, you have no means to replace it if all of the money is going to one guy. As you said, Bobby Witt Jr. and 24 guys, or 25 guys, is not going to get you anywhere.
Right, 25 guys. I keep forgetting it's 26.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't really add that extra guy a couple years ago. I do it all the time.
You know what? I still call it the DL. I still call it the 15-day DL. I don't mention the 10. Like it's just the baseball I grew up with. I'm not trying to be an ass. I'm just having trouble adjusting.
I only get Indians Guardians right like 50% of the time, and that's not me trying to be a jerk. That's just me knowing something by one name for my entire life, and then for 2 years of like life being told, no, now it's something else. And you're like, okay, I accept this, but like, there's like a good chance I'm going to get this wrong like half the time. So it's not necessarily a willful decision like calling it Jacobs Field. Like, listen, I don't need to give into your corporate sponsor. I can call the stadium anything I want, and I will continue to do so. But, you know, the rest of the stuff, yeah, I say DL too. And it's not, I'm not refusing to say IL. It's just that my brain still thinks it's called the DL. So.
All right, Irby, how about you? Where are you at on this?
I mean, same as you guys. I did not see this coming. Did not see these guys. We did believe they would be competitive and they would take the step forward. But I think we were all more sold on the Tigers taking a further step forward than Kansas City. But here we are with the Royals. And so, yeah, it's kind of funny with what happened today. And, you know, you tie up the division leader and talk games. Like, well, it's one thing to catch somebody. It's another to pass them. So there's a whole lot of baseball left. Cleveland's been there a while. Kansas City's on a heater right now. Everybody, each of these teams have gotten hot at some point, and each of these teams has gotten cold. Cleveland's been cold. Kansas City's been hot. That's why this has happened. Is it sustainable? No. Baseball will tell you no. Royals going forward, yeah, like this is, like I said, this is a playoff team more than likely because of the way the AL is. I don't know who's catching them because the – right. Well, I mean, Seattle, we'll see if they want to wake up or not. It depends on the time of day.
Yeah.
But then, Kansas City, to y'all's last point about where it's going, yes, that is the most interesting thing, because as great as this is, as nice as the step forward is, a lot's going to change, because Salvi, like, he's not there for the long term. He's 34. So at some point, he becomes DH, the backup catcher. You know, your best pitcher right now arguably is Seth Lugo, also 34. Like, not sustainable here. How much longer? And you've got multiple bullpen arms that are not going to be there. So there's a solid core. There's a couple of really good prospects coming up. This is something that you can build with and run with. But I don't know. I think we've seen teams like this before that kind of showed this flash in the pan one year. And then you make the bad signings and you make the bad moves and think you are where you're not, and it ends up costing you. So I hopefully Kansas City doesn't do that, because watching Bobby Witt Jr. play baseball and getting to see him play more primetime baseball is a good thing for the sport.
Honestly, I just can't believe Salvi's only 34.
Right? Doesn't it feel like we've been watching him for 2 decades?
Yeah, in my mind, he's like 45.
Well, and maybe he is, but he lists as 34.
Well, yeah, he might be. Having yourself a fast out Carmona situation, I suppose it's not totally out of the realm of possibility, but I thought he was so much older than that. It's like less weird to me now that he can still catch. I was probably giving him too much credit, which I don't want to take away because I like Salvi. But, you know, I was thinking that this, like, you know, decrepit, like, 40-year-old catcher was still, like, dragging his ass out there every day. I was like, oh, you're only 34. You're fine. You're fine.
All right. What else we have?
Well, I was thinking about, this is like, I don't know. I don't know if I'm asking for parenting advice or if I'm giving parenting advice or if I'm saying I don't care what you think, but I am curious what you do. Unclear, like, sort of where I'm at on this, but I was thinking about sort of the idea of, and this is going to come up in the postseason, especially if you have to travel to see your own team, which we obviously will do if the Guardians are in the, well, I mean, I think I feel fairly comfortable saying they will be in the postseason, but, you know, hopefully they will be playing games at a place that we can get to. And if, you know, if that's not New York where we live, we will obviously be going to Cleveland to see them. So the question becomes, you know, well, you got to take your kids out of school, right? How many days reasonably can you take your kids out of school to, like, you know, go to baseball games? So I'm probably not, like, the right person to be the authority on this. Like, I grew up with parents who would call you out for, like, literally anything. You just happened to get, like, you know, then Indians tickets in, like, April. You know, my parents were the ones who were like, yeah, sure, I'll call and say you're sick. You know, sure, I'll call and say you're sick so you can go to the parade the Indians are holding after they lost the World Series when you're supposed to be at school. And, you know, we've continued that tradition with our own children where I pretty much just take them out whenever there's some reason that we might want to go to a baseball game or whatever. But, like, I'm curious, you know, what did your parents do? You know, Irby, you've got kids. So what do you do with your kids? And like, you know, those of you at home, like, I don't know. Are we just like ridiculous for like ripping your kids out of school so they can go to baseball games? I'm not going to listen to you. I'll be upfront about you and tell you that this will not change anything that I do. I'm just curious how many people actually are willing to do this. And if this just falls along the lines of like, okay, so baseball fans will do this and non-baseball fans won't. So bummer for your kid if they're a baseball fan and you're not. But like, I don't know. Like, what are your thoughts on this? Like, is it totally acceptable to just take a kid out of school to go to, I don't know, any old baseball game anytime?
Well, 100% yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. That's what I thought. We would all
get yes, on the no, same no, page it, on this. What do you want? You want, I mean, parenting styles, whatever you want to talk. Like, you want a well-rounded child, right? And there's nothing wrong with talking through priorities at times. And I come from a whole family of educators, okay? Both my parents were teachers, elementary school teachers, their entire careers. Last Wednesday, second week of school, they spun the three grandsons out of school to go to a Rangers day game.
Yeah, there it is.
And the teachers are
doing it too, guys.
Yeah, exactly. And not even a second thought about it either. It was a great. They got replica World Series rings, and the boys had a wonderful time together. Great time with their grandparents. Found out later they were eating too much food, which is good too. and honestly, because I'm the same as you, Smith, I don't care. Like, we made a decision. I think I got the stare from my wife for a minute. Like, it's the second week. I'm like, yeah, I can't be anything that important. And they do everything on their laptops anyway, so they were able to make up everything that same day. Like, they were caught up right there. But I did do it's like the justifiable parenting thing. They did go for the first 3 hours of the day and then got sprung from school. So it's like, yeah, you only miss like half a day. Who cares? You're hanging out with your grandparents and your cousin. You got a World Series replica ring. You're eating food. This is good. This is a good run. This is showing, for me, it's justifying of, yes, it's showing that sometimes it's okay. It's okay to get out of the norm and do something different. It's absolutely. Now, if we were going, you know, for 2 weeks at a time, different story. But here, no, nothing wrong with it at all. Same thing with postseason. How many times, most of us fans out there, and then we're all fans of it, how many times are your team making deep, deep runs? If they're making a deep run, go. It is wonderful bonding. It will last. That bonding, that time together will last a whole lot more than was taught in that classroom that day. And I'm not hating on teaching. I'm not hating on school or anything by that. So don't come at me for that crap. It is balance. It is a work-life balance. We talk about that in our jobs. Well, there's nothing wrong with doing that with your kids as well. It is a school-life balance. And this, baseball especially, is one where the opportunity, it presents itself a whole lot more than the other sports, that there are weekday day games. It happens in the other sports, but more so in baseball. And so it's there. Take advantage of it. It's a good thing. Do it. If you haven't done it, take your kids out of school. Go to a game.
Well, any thoughts?
Can't argue with that. No. I mean, just one very simple one. If we can cancel school because of a little ice and snow on the ground, we can have excused absences for baseball. I'm going to leave it at that. That's where I'm at. Of course you can. Opening day, I cut school. I didn't cut school. My dad, we made opening day like every year I was in like middle school and high school. And always missed. Did it affect my GPA in high school? No, it did not. Still graduated with honors in high school and college. And I went to all those baseball games. So absolutely take your kids out. If it's a big game, opening day is a big day. Playoff games are big. But I'll take it a step further. You know, there are some players out there. Now, it's a little bit different now because players move around so much. But if you've got one of those top players, like a Shohei Ohtani, for example, and you only get to see him that one time, and they're in town for a Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and that Thursday's an afternoon game, take your kid to see Ohtani. Whether he's hitting or pitching. Right, that for me is another. Really, it's another reason to take your kids out of school if it's a very special player that doesn't come through often, especially a pitcher, right? Because, you know, teams can come in, but their turn of the rotation doesn't come up. One of these top pitchers, you want to see him? Take your kid to see him. Take him out of school.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with both of you. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, maybe it has something to do with if you were raised that way. But, like, you know, Irby, like you were talking about, like, you're raised by educators. Like, nobody has more respect for education than me. Like, heck, I'm working on a fourth degree right now that I will never use just because I like school so much. So this is not, like, disdain for school that's causing me to do this. It's about the fact that, especially when your kids are really young, like, they can make up the work. As you said, Irby, there's nothing they're going to learn that day that's going to change their life. But the opportunity to go to a ball game, especially a postseason game, and, you know, or Bo, like you said, to go see a really special player that you might not see again. And like, I'm with you. Like, I never went to school on opening day. Ever, because my dad and I went to the ball game every year, and I did quite well in school, and so did you. So
yeah.
I feel like this is probably not one of those things that's going to affect your child's future in any way, but it would be a real bummer to miss out on the opportunity to get to that ball game. So here we are, the official position of this podcast. You know, we love telling you this when we have one. This week is truancy, totally okay. When it's for a baseball game.
It's an not excused absence.
All right. Irby, how about you? What do you want to kick us off with tonight?
Well, you know, Samantha jumped in on the one team, charging at, competing with, trying to hang with the Guardians. So let's look at the other one. The Detroit Tigers, not the White Tigers, no, sorry. The Minnesota Twins have re-entered the conversation. And they're there, and they're close. They're three games back. They're playing 72 and 60 right now as we're sitting here recording that. Are we buying this? Is this normal? I give you mine, I'm not buying this as a sustainable run. Minnesota has not looked great since the All-Star game. In fact, they've played 500 balls since the All-Star game. Since Joe Ryan went down, the pitching staff has not been the same. Pablo Lopez and Bailey Ober has been wonderful, has been fantastic, but they haven't been great. Like, they're both over 4 ERA. And it's an offense at times that can show. It's just a very odd team that does get on base, and they Minnesota, to their credit, when they get on base, they do know how to manufacture runs, and they are scoring runs, but then they go stretches of nothing, and they're quiet, and the pitching staff at times, you know, we can look at it, they're not letting a lot of teams get on base. The best strikeout to walk ratio in the entire Major League Baseball. But we've seen this before, right? Like, this is not new. Sometimes they have an actual division lead, but here they're actually in third place. The good news is because of how the American League is playing out, that is still good for a playoff spot right now. And they are in that third wildcard spot, and everyone's four games or more behind. So this might end up as a playoff team. And at the end of the day, when Minnesota Twins are likely maybe going to be playing October baseball. But I think there's a lot of teams up there above them that have no problem playing them in the first round. I don't know. I'm not buying it.
You watch. This will be the Twins team that actually wins a playoff game. Not the series. The game. This will be the team that does it. This is the team. This will be the one that does it, Samantha, because no one's expecting it. Not that we expect.
I think they won one. Didn't they win one last year? I think they won one last year.
Did they?
They got squashed again. Yeah, they did. They won a whole series, actually, and then they just got destroyed again. But, I mean, this
so they're one up on Mike Trout.
Yeah. What a bum. noted bum, Mike Trout.
But to answer that broader question, of course not. No, I'm not buying this. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if Seattle caught him. Not buying it. No. Samantha, how about you?
Oh, yeah, I'm not buying it either. I mean, I think the thing that really stands out to me here is that Minnesota didn't actually start playing better and catch up. It was that the Guardians fell back from the pace they were at. So it's not as though the Twins got better. They just didn't get worse. And the team in front of them collapsed back a little bit, which sort of then I think allowed them to catch up a little bit. And yeah, they're not a bad team. They're probably going to the playoffs. The AL Central has been quite good this year, but like, I don't know, like they just can't seem to get out of their own way. They had a lot of opportunity. Well, Cleveland and Kansas City were playing each other. That should be a good opportunity for you to make some strides. And instead they fell further back somehow. While the two in front of you were playing each other, you managed to fall further behind. That doesn't make any sense. Like, I just think they really, really are not, I don't know. We've been back and forth this year on, you know, who's the bigger threat to Cleveland in this division? Is it Kansas City or is it Minnesota? First we thought it was Kansas City, then we thought it was Minnesota. Now we're back to Kansas City again, and that may change again. But what hasn't changed is that Cleveland remains the team in front, and I just don't think Minnesota. Where's that soundbite of Rick Manning? Were we promised the soundbite, or we're going to try to get the soundbite of Rick Manning yelling, "Smiley wants to kill himself"? Because that's what I think the Twins are doing right now. Like, watch them. Like, it looks like a suicide mission, and they are not a strong team traditionally in the second half. And yeah, I think they're going to hang on, and I think they're going to keep that playoff spot. But I don't think they're really a threat in the division. I will put that out there right now.
No, I mean, it's not an organization that has a good September. Right? Like not in the past. Not in the last, I don't know, 30 years. They don't have a good September, so why would you think that they would suddenly have one and make that push? No, I'm not buying this. Maybe because the Mariners don't want it, maybe they'll take that last playoff spot. But that's about it, and you're not going to go far.
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, boy.
That is definitely working in your favor when you look at that Mariners offense and go, "Oh, that's what's chasing us? Okay, we can lose this series. We're fine."
Oh, the Mariners. We'll get to them in a second, but my gosh. That pitching staff, and you can't do better than this? That's insane.
Yeah. So, all right, well, on the other end of the spectrum, another team that's sitting there at not as good of a record, but I feel like might be a little bit more of a conversation, and that is those New York Mets. Head over to that NL side. The New York Mets sitting only 6 games above 500. They are not going to win this division. They are not going to catch the Phillies. We're not going to sit here and tell you that. That's not going to happen. But they only are 3 games out of the playoffs right now. And this is a team that finished 12 games under 500 last year. That's a team that started the year with pitchers like Justin Verlander, Max Scherzer, Carlos Carrasco, and Kode Senga, who did start the year with the Mets this year, got one start, and then he was done. Now, you're sitting here with a Mets team that is, at best, very inconsistent. They lead, some of the categories they lead in are amazing. Some of the categories they're not doing, it's so weird to watch what they're doing. They can win series and they go out and they compete in these series against the Padres and the Orioles and the Twins that we mentioned. And they even took care of the Yankees. And then they can't win a series against anybody in the AL West. Like, they're struggling against the Angels and the A's and the Mariners. I mean, Bo, you're talking about that. We're here talking about the Mariners often. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The Mariners in a 3-game series outscored these guys 22-1 recently. Like, it's just a weird enigma of a team that has a borderline top 10 offense and a pitching staff that's getting the job done. The problem is this sustainable? And so I don't know. For me, I have more confidence in this Mets team because they literally have nothing. I mean, it's all house money. It was always house money. This is not supposed to be a playoff team. These guys weren't supposed to be here. Mm-hmm. With what we saw, and I know the Braves have had injury situations, stuff like that, but what we've seen with the Phillies and the Braves and where they've been going, like, it was always never it was never going to be the Mets conversation. You know, there was probably concern that they would have a harder time with teams like the Nationals catching them. Well, that never happened. So, yeah, it's house money. Like, you're fine, and if you don't make the playoffs, it's okay. You weren't supposed to be a playoff team. Finishing above 500 this season is a win for this team, you know, because it is chasing the Braves, the Diamondbacks, the Padres. Those are not easy to catch.
Right.
This is a totally different situation than what we were talking about with Minnesota. So I don't know. I mean, it's such a weird team to watch. I'm glad to see Francisco Lindor's refound his pop and everything. It's strange that the one black hole in their offense is the 2022 batting champ Jeff McNeil. So whatever. It's a very odd team, but I it's not a bad team. This is actually a good Mets team.
So yeah, Irby, on the one hand, I mean, I really want to buy them just because they've been such a fun, they've been a fun story, not necessarily a fun team, but between the Grimace thing and everything going on with them, like they've been fun. I will say that about the Mets. They've been fun. And I would venture to say they've already had a successful season compared to where they were expected to be. I think they're already there. Now, we have to give them a reality check because you're six behind the Padres and the Diamondbacks. You're three behind the Braves. And unless, one, you're not catching the Padres or the Diamondbacks unless they just have a catastrophic September. And I could say the same thing about the Braves. It's almost like the Braves would have to let them win it if they were to actually get that spot and go in there. Samantha, what about you? Where are you at on this?
Okay, wait. Didn't you, like, 2 weeks ago say that you thought the Mets would steal that spot from the Braves?
Well, it's been 2 weeks, and they've gained no... In fact, they've lost ground since that show.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. I just wanted to put that out there.
Yeah.
That, like, okay, like, there was a point...
There was.
At least one person on this podcast fully believed the Mets were going to steal that spot from the Braves, which would have been hilarious, but... But to that end, yeah, I mean, I kind of hope they get in because they're fun, like you said. I mean, we all love the Grimace thing, right? And the Mets, you know, however spazzy and how much we make fun of them, they're a fun team. They're certainly well-intentioned, if not particularly good at execution in a lot of ways. But, you know, this is good. They were supposed to be terrible, right? Like, this was supposed to be the whoops we overspent last year and we were awful. So now we really need to dial it back, regroup, figure out where we're at, evaluate the players that we have and figure out what we need to do to succeed in the future and cut payroll. And surprise, they're better than they were a year ago, which is hard to explain, very hard to explain from a logic standpoint, but that's what's great about baseball, right? It doesn't always make sense. So yeah, no, I think this is cool. I'm glad to see him do it. You know, Francisco Lindor is probably your MVP if Otani isn't around. So that's pretty cool too, especially for a guy who's been given, I think, unfairly a very hard time by that fan base at various points because, you know, he, like all other humans, is not capable of living up to a large contract every single day of his life. So I'm really happy to see him being so successful just to kind of quiet some of that ridiculousness down too. So that's cool. But yeah, good for the Mets. Good for the Mets. I hope they can at least stick around for a little while, make it interesting.
All right, Irby. What else do you have for us?
All right, well, so my last one, and this kind of came from, you know, I mean, the games that we go to, we, you know, Samantha, we talked about that, and the Danny Jansen game that we had on Monday, and it got thinking about sports memorabilia. And we all have our desk, you know, at home office, wherever it is, you've got bobbleheads and baseballs and footballs, bats, whatever your sport is, you've got those handful of things. So taking money out of the equation. Like, the money is not the issue. What is something, one thing, code thing, what is something that you would buy if money was not in the equation here? Stuff that, like, you know, I mean, and celebrating Danny, like, man, gosh, wouldn't you love to have something from Danny Jansen on Monday? Stuff like that. And as I thought about it, and I actually was talking to some friends and getting their opinions as well of some of the things they would get to and some fascinating directions this goes. There's kind of three different areas that you would look at, and one would be a something historical value, like a piece of history, a baseball from one of the original games, basically in the Civil War, a uniform from the original college football game in the 1860s, stuff like that. And you know, for me, it would be the national championship when the Longhorns beat USC. I would love the football when the defense stuffed Lindell White. That led to the the comeback win. And friend of mine, Dylan, gave me the best one. He said he would love to have a decapitated skull from the ancient Aztec ball game basketball that they used to play some 4,000 years ago.
Okay, well, he wins. What? Let's all quit. He wins.
Exactly.
That's a good answer. I was not even, that didn't even occur to me. But yeah, no, he wins. Dylan, you win.
Wow.
That's awesome. I never even thought about it. What a good idea.
Yes. So yeah, that's the one with the historic. The second is kind of a ballpark stadium, something that has that an emotional connection to you or something to the significance of an arena from there. And the one for me, it would be, I would love to have like a movie sports room and it would have actual comfortable seating as well, but then have like 2 to 4 seating sections from like the old ballpark or Reunion Arena, maybe even some from the Kingdom, something like historical stuff like that. And that was mine. The best one there, friend of the show Dallas said that he would love to have Ted Williams' cowboy hat from the inaugural game in Arlington back in 1972. So there's one. I was like, wow, that's a moment and everything. So, and then the third area, the one everyone is specific players, specific pieces of memorabilia, something like that, that, you know, in this time and that one. So I Holly, I mean, Ranger fans, Bo, I know you and me, it would be easy stuff like that. And, you know, I would, the ball and the bat when Marcus Semien hit the game, the game 5 home run in the World Series. Friend of the show, Kevin, said he's a big Mavs fan, Dirk Nowitzki's jersey from the game 6 NBA Finals. Weird ones, too. Dallas also, the Lou Gehrig jersey when he had his last game in his consecutive game streak would be where he would spend his money. Dylan, who already nailed it with the Aztec one, said it would be the baseball and maybe even the bird that Randy Johnson killed.
What's left of the bird?
Oh, my gosh. Okay, he's my favorite. Can he come on the show? I think that'd be a great guest segment because, like, the bird skeleton would be amazing.
Jeez. Probably even set it up like, you know, the ball just hit it or something like that. But then my last one there, before I turn it over to you guys, is I would love to have the cleats that Benji Molina was wearing when he hit for the cycle.
That's a good one. Yeah.
Yeah, that's good too. I like that.
So that's how good about you guys? What is in those three categories or just something that, yeah, it's like, I,
wow.
Money is no object. Money is no object here.
Man, mine sounds kind of boring now. Like, it really does. It's kind of boring, but I'm going to say it anyway. The one thing I would like is, and I would spend whatever it took to get all of this because it's multiple things, but I want a piece of memorabilia from every single sitting record in baseball, not the record breaker, the sitting record. So for example, I want the ball from Nolan Ryan's final strikeout. I want the ball. Well, it's not the record, but I want the last home run that Barry Bonds hit, even though we're not really recognizing that, but still. I want the last home run ball that Barry Bonds hit, right? I want the base from Ricky Henderson's last stolen base. That's the type of memorabilia I would cherish and put in a special case somewhere in my house, which, again, I know, sounds boring compared to Aztec heads.
No, but I like that. I think it's cool because you can make any little museum out of that.
Yeah.
You know, I know. I actually think that's a cool idea. I like that.
Yeah. So, Samantha, what about you?
Okay, I have 3. One of them will go chronological-ish. Arnold Rothstein's betting slips from 1919.
Oh,
you know how badly I would love to get a
hold of those? There you go.
Now you're thinking. That's awesome. That's a good one. Yeah.
So that's my first one. My second one is the Albert Bell corked bat, you know, the one that Jason Grimsley tried to crawl through the ceiling into the other locker room to go retrieve after the White Sox took it so that they could take it to prove he was cheating. So I want the bat and I want the ceiling tile that he had to move to get through there. And then my last one, just because this is one of my favorite goofy baseball moments ever. You remember when Lloyd McClendon got so mad about that call that he went out and ripped the base out of the ground and took the base with him and walked off the field after he got ejected? I want that base.
Yep.
So those are mine. Yep.
Can I get every single hat Lou Piniella kicked around arguing with umpires?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, like, with the dirt on it after he kicked
with
it around.
The dirt. Like, with the dirt. Good. With the dirt, yeah. You have to put that in one of those climate-controlled cases so everything stays pristine.
Oh, yeah. Well, do you remember how the ESPN zones used to have those plastic hot dogs on the wall and they had dirt inside the hot dog from every ballpark? I thought that was the coolest thing ever. Cool. Mm-hmm. Like, you could do that with the Lou Piniella hats. Like, I bet you could hit a solid number of ballparks for all the times he did that.
Probably good, yeah.
Oh, that's so cool. I wish we could get all this stuff, especially the Aztec heads.
I really want that now. I didn't even know that existed.
Right? Yeah, that was so cool.
I did know about that. It just would never have even occurred to me to give that as an answer, and it's like the best answer ever. Well done. It's just so great.
You got to get every home run. I got a game-winning skull.
Yeah. Oh, that's amazing.
That's right up there with the goat's head from that show Coach. Where they had this prospect for a kicker, and he was from a country in one of those old Russian republics, and he was kicking goat's heads, and they were comparing what the goat's head, the size of a goat's head with a regulation football, and it was comparable, so they wanted to go get the kid.
Goat's
heads. Goat's heads. Yeah.
Oh, God.
Kicking goat's heads.
I don't want to laugh at that, but I'm laughing at that.
Oh boy. All right. Irby, anything else on this one before we move on?
No. That was a fun one. I loved y'all's answers too. There's some good stuff in there and I think that's the beauty of it, something like the memorabilia. It's not always the stuff that we think of. It's the ones that have that emotional, that sentimental value. Because I'm a catcher. Yes, Benji Molina, he was all of us that day. All catchers were helping him run that triple. Every catcher ever was pushing that ball off the wall in an awkward way and pushing Benji to get the third, because that's what we do.
I don't know, Irby. I'm pretty sure you're faster than Benji Molina.
Yes, probably. Yes, on that, the way that ball bounced, I probably could have gotten a triple too, but Benji was all of us that day. He had the opportunity and he went for it. And the best part about it is it's a wonderful video. The last, 40 feet, he has already put the brakes on. It's amazing. Like, there's no rounding third, I'm going home. It is, I have rounded second, let's go ahead and put the trailer back on and begin slowing down.
Oh, I'm just glad that the Rangers office exploded that day, so he was able to go for that triple and not really, if he got thrown out, wasn't a big deal.
Yeah.
Really.
Maybe the stars aligned. Triple in baseball history. It might be the slowest triple ever.
Kind of makes you wonder if, like, the official scorer, like saw it bounce off the wall, was like, you know, maybe I'm going to give a double with an error. And I said, no, I can't do that to him. Why not? All right. Well, speaking of errors, we got to talk about this, I think, because granted, this did happen. It happened the day that we posted our show last week. Scott Service being dismissed very unceremoniously by the Mariners. And it kind of makes me wonder, Smith, did Jerry DePoto try to trade him and couldn't? So he released him. Is that where we were at here with this? Because none of this makes sense to me. Right, you're still in the fight, right? You're fighting for a playoff spot, be a wild card. You're still technically kind of in it with Houston. Not really in it, but kind of in it. And your idea and to jumpstart things is to fire the manager in the middle of a pennant. This is so Seattle. This is such a Seattle decision. I know we question them a lot, but I really am now. Like, why do they always make the wrong decision on everything they do? This one was way out. It came out of nowhere, and I don't see the I don't see what this accomplishes. I don't see how this helps them get past Houston or past Minnesota and get that final wild card spot. I don't see how this helps. I see how it would hurt, because now you got a team that has a whole new leader, They have a new hitting coach, which fine. Could have made that move at the middle of the season. I get that. But a whole new field general? I don't understand it, Samantha.
Yeah, cue up the soundbite we don't have. Drew Smiley wants to kill himself again. I just, why would you do this? Why would you fire your man? The only time you fire your manager in the middle of a pennant race is when he has done something that is so awful that you have to fire him that has nothing to do with the baseball because you're not allowed to keep him. Like, this yeah. is crazy to me. I there is not a scenario. We've seen teams fire their manager early on and then go on to make the playoffs. But these were not teams that were in a pennant race at the time. They were out of it. Look what happened with Philadelphia a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
When Johnson came in. And it's like, okay, sure, yeah, we've seen people take a team that looked really underachieving and lethargic early on and turn them back into the playoff team that they were supposed to be. But why would you fire somebody when they were already in the midst of a play? I mean, what? Of all the stupid things that the Mariners have done this year, explain to me how Scott Servais is responsible for the fact right. that, like, I just, it's a little hard to believe. And then we have this additional little piece of it where apparently he found out on social media because Jerry couldn't resist telling someone else mm-hmm. before he told him, which is just, again, I mean, that just adds to the whole, like, incompetence of it all. So it's like, oh, well, it makes me question your decision even more, considering that you botched the actual firing in addition to the fact that you should never have done it in the first place. It just makes me trust your reasoning even less because you couldn't even get it together to fire someone correctly. Like, mm-hmm. this just seems nuts to me. Like, I don't know, man. Like, again, let's go back to the day when Bo said they were the most embarrassing team to be a fan of, and I was like, I don't know. And it's like, no, that was right. He was right. This is embarrassing. You should be embarrassed.
Yeah, they
like,
should.
This is crazy. Like, well, oh, Jerry.
I mean, come on. I mean, let's actually take a look at this from a different angle. Let's treat this like he did it in the offseason, which is obviously a much more, you know,
civilized.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. Like it's a much more appropriate time. That's the word I was looking for here.
There you go.
A much more appropriate time to make a move like that is the offseason. But let's take a look at let's say that this was something that happened the first week after the season. When we typically get these managerial firings, I want somebody in that Seattle press to sit there at that press conference and ask Jerry, what exactly were you expecting him to do with the team you built? Because mm-hmm. that was the problem. And it's still the problem in Seattle. It's not the manager. It's what she gave him to work with. And that's on the general manager, who I hope is fired very unceremoniously very soon. Irby, how about you?
Yeah.
No, that's it right there. That's exactly what it is. This is what did you expect with this roster? Like it's well, the guys aren't hitting. Yeah, because you've got guys on the team that aren't hitters. That's how exactly. this works. Like it's Scott Servais wasn't going to be the one that figures it out. But no, this is Jerry. I half expected him after firing. He's like, oh, it'll make sense later or some crap like that.
Yeah, when he gets fired.
It's so weird how he goes about business. It's so weird how he goes about these things. And it's almost like he plays MLB The Show in franchise mode. And it's like, well, I make these move on there and it works out. Like, yeah, well, it's a video game. This is real life. Like, You go out and you add pieces that are helpful and it's going to make the team better, but they're not going to, I don't know. It's just so strange. It's just like, this is the most Seattle thing out there. The embarrassment of what you guys said, that is exactly right to get rid of it in a race. I mean, yes, I know they had dropped to 500 and I guess that was the last straw. I can see Jerry doing that. I'm like, well, if you get to 500, I'm going to fire you. He probably said that at the All-Star break. Like, well, if we drop to 500, you'll get fired. And no one thought anything of it. And it turns out he was being serious. Everybody else in the room thought he was joking. He was being serious. And so you do this, and it doesn't help the clubhouse. Like, did you think getting rid of Scott and adding Dan Wilson to the equation would be like, oh, now the clubhouse like, oh, okay, finally. this is what we need. This is the catalyst we need to start hitting the ball, to start winning baseball games. This is the record that you have. This is who you are. You're a 500 team. I know that you had the lead, and you've lost the lead. That's because you were playing above yourself. You've got an amazing pitching staff, and the pitching's doing awesome. That's great. It doesn't count for crap because there's two sides of the ball. That is the sport. That has been the sport forever. You have to do both sides. It doesn't matter. We famously got to do that 2 decades ago when the Rangers thought, oh, we'll just score 12 runs a game and we'll beat everybody. Like, oh, that doesn't help when you're giving up 13.
Really doesn't.
You know, I know it wasn't that bad, but still, it was the same. It's like, the Rangers are giving up 8 runs a game. It's like, yeah, but their offense can score 7. Well, 8 is higher than 7, so we lose, and they lost. It's the opposite thing here. It's like, okay, great pitching staff. It's not going to do it because you don't have the offense, and the offense that you need is doing well at the other teams. I mean, we see what Hernandez is doing in L.A., but whatever. This is on you. So I guess that's what it is. I got to get rid of him to save my own job. Had it happened in the offseason, sure. That is the only reason there. Like, if this happened in the offseason, I get it. It's time to make a change. I wonder if DePoto's under the gun. And so you did this move now knowing that I got to do something. If these guys don't, if we lose this and we don't make the postseason, I'm out of a job as well. So I got to do something drastic.
Yeah. Well, he should be fired too. The bottom line, right? Like, he should be fired too. He's the one that built this team. He's the one that built an underachieving team. He's the one that traded one of his big bullpen pieces to his division rival in the middle of a pennant race and said it would make sense later. Come on, Seattle. Enough's enough. That's it, Samantha. Enough's enough. If they don't fire this guy, but when this season's over, honestly, I wouldn't wait. Just fire him now. If he thinks he can go and fire his manager in the middle of a pennant race, then by God, the GM can be fired too.
Fire him before he fires anyone else he probably shouldn't be firing. I don't know. This guy's been making this mess since long before Scott Service was working there. So, I mean, this is just, explain to me what Scott Service was supposed to do when you gave him no hitters. Zero. Like, just what was he supposed to do about that? But, RB, I think you're right. Yeah, I think, you know, this is, we see it, we talk about it more in football, but we see it in baseball too, where the GM is fighting for his life. So what's he going to do? You know, like, oh, well, you fire somebody under you because if you get that dead cat bounce from it, it might save your job. So every man for himself, I guess. But, oh, Jerry, I'm sure it'll make sense later.
Yeah, again, when he's fired, as it should. Okay, so going on to another thing that annoyed the ever-living hell out of me. Barry Bonds is back in the news. I'm sure you guys saw this. We all know he's a lightning rod, right? Like, you know, he's a lightning rod of controversy between, you know, the alleged, it was never proven, I don't think, steroid use. Although it's pretty obvious that's what was going on. To the way he dealt with the press, which is really the true reason, I think, Samantha, why he's not in the Hall of Fame, is the way he dealt with the press, the people voting for this thing. But now he's reached this point now where he's philosophical. He says, I don't have to worry about those things no more in my life. I want to hang around my grandchildren and my children. Those hopes of making the Hall of Fame, I don't have them anymore. I hope to breathe tomorrow and see if I can make it to 61. That's the quote. And I, for the life, you know, what Barry Bonds should be is one or the other. Right. If he had gone out there and just ripped everyone a new one and said, you know, I was the greatest home run hitter of all time. And those of you that say that steroids is the reason why, to hell with you. I would have respected that a hell of a lot more than this PR garbage that he's spewing, this woe is me martyr shit. Like, I would respect the other side of that argument a lot more than this.
I guess I just don't understand what the goal of this is. Like, it's like, we're making an announcement to tell you there is no announcement is essentially what's happening here, right? Like, I'd like to tell you that I don't care. Like, but then why do you need to tell anyone? If you didn't care, you just wouldn't care. you wouldn't have anything to say about it. And, like, look, if Barry Bonds' whole thing now is, like, I'm past that point in my life. I just want to hang out with my grandkids, or he wants to breathe tomorrow. Like, good for you, Barry. Way to set those goals high. Breathe tomorrow. All right. But, like, good for him. Very Rocky's ass. Just want to be alive tomorrow. Road to 500. But, like, you know, if he's just moved on from it and he doesn't care anymore, then, like, good for him. Like, that's great. Good for you. But, like, I'm not sure I buy that, because if you really had moved on like that, I don't think you would be out there waxing philosophical about it. Because I agree with you. Like, I would respect this a lot more if he was either coming out and saying, no, I'm hurt, I belong in the Hall of Fame, if he was still trying to make his case, or if he was saying, F you, I don't need you, Hall of Fame, I'm the greatest hitter ever. But this sort of going down the middle where it's like, yes, I've become all zen about it, but, you know, I still feel the need to continue talking to everyone about it. I don't buy it. And, like, to your point, Bo, I mean, Barry Bonds' biggest problem wasn't that he took steroids, it was that he was a colossal jerk.
Yes.
You know, and then the same goes for Roger Clemens, by the way. So, like, both of them, they put themselves in a really bad position that other people who we actually know use steroids are not in nearly as bad of a spot, because they weren't complete assholes to everyone around them. So the two of them made their bed and have to lie in it now. And it's like, look, man, like, there's a lot to the whole, like, the way that you treat people kind of matters. And Bonds and Clemens both had the opportunity to position themselves more like McGuire and Sosa, more like even Alex Rodriguez, and they chose not to do that because these guys had established themselves as essentially bad humans long before we knew they were taking steroids. Like, you remember when Roger Clemens knocked up, like, 15-year-old Mindy McCready or whatever, and then she killed herself? Like, bad person. You know what I mean? Like, it's not the steroids, man. It's the fact that you were such a terrible person that nobody was going to give you any quarter on the steroids. Mm-hmm. So if Barry has become a better guy and he just wants to hang out with his grandkids, that's great. But when it mattered, he put himself in a position where there's no coming back from it. And the fact that he's become all zen about it isn't going to change anybody's mind. But it does tell me that no matter what the words say, the message is that he actually does care very much about this.
Irby, how about you? What are your thoughts here?
I'm not going to follow up much there. I agree everything. Like, well said. I mean, it's you walk one of the lines, don't walk both. So, but the way you said that, I did, like, he's Angela from The Office.
Yeah.
Wow.
Like, you know the episode with the party planning committee, and then there's the committee to plan parties?
Yes.
And that's the announcement. It's like, I just want to make an announcement that your paychecks will be delivered in the right amount and on time.
Yes. That's perfect. Secretary. I forgot about that. Yep.
There's other things. We don't have to go too deep, but we could do a whole segment on that of just Barry Bonds as Angela from The Office. But it's pick a lane. Like, pick one and no, when you do this I guess passive aggressive, whatever you want to call it, it absolutely screams that you're dying, that you can't be there and you can't be in it. And whether it's that you look back and you regret the way that you acted, maybe. So I don't know. I mean, that's where all this steroid stuff, it's the one I've always held on to. I respected the most the Gary Sheffield one when he came out and said, yeah, I took them. And this is why I took them. And I know Pettit kind of did the same thing. I took it for this reason. I look back now, that was a mistake. I shouldn't have done that. I get it. You're human. You're trying to hold on to something. We're all human. We get it. Admit your mistakes. Apologize. Moving forward. But this, no. Sorry. I didn't have time for them then. I don't have time for them now. Because you don't hit a growth spurt in your mid-30s.
it's not completed in one off season either. Which was the really damning part.
Yeah. I guess in your mid-30s, you have a different kind of growth spurt, but you don't have a muscular growth spurt.
No!
Did you finally hit puberty? No.
Also, the shape of your head doesn't change. Like, let's just... there is no diet you can go on or go off that does that. Like, come on, man. Like, be real. Like, America loves a forgiveness story. If you had just said sorry and meant it, we'd probably be having a real different conversation right now.
True. Look at Andy Pettit. Perfect example.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So before we go, one more fun game I have for you guys before we call it a night. So we all know about the Chargers getting the 12 of the Chargers getting stuck in an elevator in Dallas when they were here to play the Cowboys. So that got me thinking, like, who would you want to be and who would you not want to be stuck in an elevator with in sports? So you can pick your best or worst, best and worst. Let's do both. Best and worst players or teams. It could be a single player or a team or a fraction of a team, because obviously you can't put a 53-man football roster in an elevator or a 26-man baseball roster. So you can mix and match, whatever you want to do there. The only rules are you cannot use your favorite teams, and you can't use the trash cans for the worst. Anybody got that?
Yes.
Any questions, comments, got concerns, it. Theories, anecdotes? All right, so best for me, best, I would want to have that 2004 Red Sox team.
Yeah.
Right?
God. Yeah, that would be fun.
Right, David That's Ortiz. David Ortiz alone by himself would be even better. Not even better, but he would be just, you know, that's what makes it, right? But, you know, everybody else on that team, that's who I want. The 04 Red Sox, for me, for the best. Now, the worst is actually a player. I'm talking about one Jose Siri out of Tampa, because I can't stand that guy.
I really hate Jose Siri.
And the thing is,
so funny to me.
And the thing is, it's actually specifically worse in this situation that is not a guy that is going to sit there and wait for help. He's going to be bouncing all over the elevator. He's going to be doing annoying things left and right, the same thing he does while he's waiting on a fly ball in the outfield. Okay, that's what Jose Siri is going to do the entire time. None of it's going to be helpful or entertaining, just annoying. So that is my worst. My best is the 04 Red Sox. My worst is Jose Siri. So, Samantha, how about you?
I kind of want to be stuck in an elevator with Kirk Cousins. I feel like that would be amazing.
You like that?
My second choice would be Ryan Fitzpatrick. But I think I want to be stuck in an elevator with Kirk Cousins. I've thought about this, and I feel very strongly about it. as far as who I don't want to be stuck in an elevator with, that list is long. Actually, both lists are long, but this list is especially long. I'm just trying to decide who the absolute worst would be. I mean, there's a part of me that would be really, really concerned about getting stuck in an elevator with Garrett Cole, because you just know he would be the person who would completely panic.
True.
Which is the worst scenario I can think of. I would rather be in there with somebody who was annoying and wouldn't shut up, even though I would hate that too, than somebody who flew into a panic and freaked out and tried to climb out of the elevator. So there's probably a better example out there than Garrett Cole, but he is the first person that came into my mind of who would just flip their shit if they got stuck in an elevator, and immediately my brain went, Garrett Cole. So, you know, I think we're going Kirk Cousins, good, Garrett Cole, bad here.
See, my brain went Jose Siri for the bad immediately. that was not something I had to think about. All right, Irby, how about you? Who's your best and worst to be stuck in an elevator with?
Well, worst, any and all offensive and defensive linemen. And I'm sure that's why we had the situation here with the Chargers. Got a bunch of linemen in there all jumping up and down.
Are you calling the linemen fat?
I mean, the shoe fits.
In this situation, yeah. I don't need y'all in here. This is already a bad situation. We don't need to have excess weight.
That's the part of the team, you know, they're all millionaires and they still eat a Golden Corral. Okay, come on, let's just call it what it is.
Yeah, there you go. I guess I'm bound to say that I wouldn't want to have Mike Trout in there, because it would probably get caught at some point. He'd look at me, so you're the guy that called me a bum?
See, Mike Trout would go MacGyver, get out, and leave you there because you called him a bum.
Well, and that might be, he might be the best one, too, for that reason, too. I could see, or what's the one, Daniel Norris is the kind of guy that would be a best. I feel like he'd be the one to be oh, no, I'd get us out of here. Really? How?
Oh, yeah. No, he would be, you're right. He would just, like, repair the elevator or, like, build you a tunnel out of it or something. Yeah, no, that's a good one. Ooh, yeah.
That would ding. And then not the same thing as an elevator, but I have experienced this in a little bit of a way. When I was in college working in the sports information with the Longhorn women's soccer team, there was a tornado warning, and we all had to get in a shed for a few minutes. And that was, you know, as a college boy, have to hang out in a shed with a bunch of college soccer players. Yeah, that was rough.
Actually,
Daniel Norris would be the one. That would be the one I'd feel like he's going to lead us safely.
Yeah.
I'm just going to picture all these linemen with their to-go bags from Golden Corral. I'm sorry, you guys. This came up because these guys had to explain to me that Golden Corral was not a strip club because I thought it was a strip club. And when I asked my husband if it was a strip club, he said yes, because he thought it was funny that I thought that. So I was walking around thinking Golden Corral was a strip club. And these two had to correct me. So anyway, now all weird, like, buffet-style food references come back to the Golden Corral. Which I don't want to be in an elevator with either. Whether it's a strip club or a buffet, don't want to be in that elevator.
Anybody with Golden Corral to go?
Yikes.
I actually just thought of a good honorable mention for worst. Oil Can Boyd. The guy yelled at baseballs. What's he going to do stuck in an elevator?
But see, one, like, if you get someone yelling, like a Lou Piniella or Oil Kid, someone that's just going to yell and scream at, like, the operator on there, like, that would, for an entertaining purpose, would be fun.
That's true.
It also might get you help faster because someone might hear them.
That's true, too.
This is true.
That's a good point. I didn't think of that.
There you go.
Wow. I'm still not pulling Jose Siri out of the Hurt Locker, though. No.
I don't think he would help you with that. Yeah.
Earl Weaver. That would be a good one.
Earl Weaver. No, Earl Weaver, it's like 50-50. Either someone would come rescue you immediately or someone would decide they were never going to rescue you from what they would get out of that elevator.
To know what 911 operator we get.
Oh, yeah. I can hear it now. Sir, help's on the way. Okay, how but it'll be about an hour. Ah, bullshit. I can hear it now.
There's urban search and rescue coming now.
Oh, shit, get here faster. Oh, my God. All right. Anything else on this before we call it a week?
I don't want to be in there with a mask guy because they smell.
They smell and they take up half the elevator.
I mean, yeah.
Do you like the Philly Fanatic? Space.
Yeah, and those things, like, they're clean, like, one day a year. The first day of the season, anytime after that, you don't want to be in there with a mask on. And they stink, and you can't get away from them because they take up the whole elevator. So,
yeah. I get that. Yeah.
Mascot. We love mascots, but not an elevator.
Not an elevator. No. Not in an elevator. All right. Well, wherever you're listening to Lollygagging Sports, give us a like, subscribe to the show. Help us out with that algorithm so we can get some more lollygaggers in here to talk about mascots and elevators. But for this week, we're done. We're out of here. Until next week, watch some baseball. It's good for you. We'll be right back.